different. My name is Jeff Wasserstrom. It's a great pleasure for me to get to moderate this session on propaganda and disinformation with, on my left, on my left, four wonderful speakers. First, Molly Roberts, who came up from UC San Diego, a leading scholar of issues of the internet and censorship in China. Next to her, Fumi Arewa, a colleague from the law school here, who has many, many different kinds of interests, running the gamut from music to law to wearing the hat she's wearing here, the director of the Center on Africa and the Law at UCI. Next to her, Barbara Demick, the LA Times. Everybody has multiple hats that they'll be taking turns putting on as they respond to questions. They'll all be talking both about the US and about another part of the world or two parts of the world. Barbara is the author of Nothing to Envy, a prize-winning book on North Korea. She's also written on the former Yugoslavia and on China. And then Pardis Mahdavi from Pomona College, who is an anthropologist who has worked on Iran and on the Gulf states and different parts of the world, has worked on human trafficking and other issues as well. So to repeat a couple of things, I want to thank the Humanities Commons that helps make everything that we do at the Forum for the Academy and the Public possible, and my wonderful collaborator, Amy Wilentz. People have said throughout that it was prescient and is kind of scary, so I'm really worried what the next topic and the year after that will be, and if Amy ever suggests we do nuclear winter on leaving town, buying land in New Zealand. But I would say this, it's incredibly ahead of the curve for Americans to be thinking right now about issues of information. How do you get it? Can you believe anything that is coming out of the mouth of the leader of the country? These are new phenomenon for Americans, perhaps. But I don't think it's any accident that Amy and I, in talking about this, Amy has worked on other parts of the world. I think that matters. And I think everybody on this panel, while feeling very upset about things that have been going on in the United States, one form of that is a sense that things that we are very familiar with, but thought of as in relation to the other place or other places that we study, that we spend time, that we have people we care about living in. So there's a sense of deja vu of even the newest things going on, but they're deja vu not necessarily of things that have happened in this country, though there are deja vus to that as well, and we shouldn't forget that of many of the things, but also a sense that things that we thought were safely or anything but safely familiar in some other place are now coming here. So I want to start by getting each of the speakers to talk briefly in responding to two basic questions. One is to talk about how listening to the conversation so far, this wide-ranging conversation, what it sparks in relation to someplace other than the United States that they know deeply. And then we'll bring the discussion back to the United States. So this will go in different directions, but it will go around the world. And I think going around the world is important. If we are feeling this sense of deja vu, then we need to be, Americans are used to trying to teach other parts of the world, but now we may have lessons to learn in terms of resistance and survival from other parts of the world that have gone through some of the phenomena we're going through now. So I'll just hand the mic down.
First of all, I just want to say this has been such an awesome opportunity and I've learned so much already today. So I study China and I study censorship and propaganda in China. And I just wanted to sort of bring three observations from China to the U.S. case, and I'm not sure, I don't have empirical facts on how exactly they apply, but I think they might, and so I sort of a call for research maybe in this area. So when I talk about facts, I'm going to talk about actual empirical facts, so how many people were at the inauguration, or how quickly is the Chinese economy growing, and So that's going to be different from interpretation, which is what you do with those facts, right? So the first observation is that when people say they believe something, they may not actually believe it. And there's something that's different between belief and what we think about as like cheerleading, right? So in China and in authoritarian regimes all around the world, there's a lot of reasons to say you believe something when you don't necessarily believe it. And that it's hard sometimes to piece those things out. And this is because of preference falsification, there might be some reason why you don't want to say you believe something, or because of what we think of as cognitive dissonance in social sciences, that it's easier for you to think to say you believe something and not to admit you believe something else. And where I think this applies to the US is we hear a lot about motivated reasoning in the US. We hear a lot about people believe things because they want to believe them because of their ideology. I've heard some statistics quoted of enormous numbers of people who believe that Barack Obama was a Muslim or was born outside of the United States. And I think what we have to distinguish between belief and cheerleading in this case. So there are social scientists at UCSD who have done some work saying that when you ask someone if they believe something, they will do this motivated reasoning thing. But when you ask them if they believe something and then you pay them to get the right answer, that number goes way down, okay? So there's difference between cheerleading and belief, and we sort of have to distinguish between those, and we have to think about the implications of that for the spread of information too. So that's sort of an open question. The second is that a lot of censorship and propaganda in China some of it is untruths or misrepresenting facts, but most of it, I think, is actually agenda setting rather than misrepresenting facts. So agenda setting, what I mean by that is putting the facts that you want people to hear up front and putting the facts that you don't want people to hear in the back. So a lot of censorship is putting the articles that you want on the front page and hiding the articles that you don't want on the back page. So there are directives to newspapers that are leaked in China telling people to put articles on the back pages. Their search filtering is something that's used in China, which puts information lower in your search algorithm, right, and puts other information higher in your search algorithm. And it doesn't mean that any of this information is false, it just means that there's some information that's more easily accessible than others. And I've shown in my own research that people are really lazy when they're online, and they're most likely to click on the thing that's most at the top, right? And so even if that means that they've just seen some facts and not others, and I think that we have to sort of think about what the agenda setting of facts, what implications that has versus actual misinformation, right? Those are two separate issues. And the reason why this has come up a lot in the US is because the news media itself is doing less agenda setting now than algorithms. So Facebook, what's on the top of your Facebook feed is agenda setting for you now. And we have to think about what that means for what people consume and what they believe, or what facts they actually have access to. And so having access to facts is just as important as making sure that they're factual. And then the third thing that I was thinking about with this was how do we credibly present facts to people? So one of the interesting things about the China case is that the government justifies its censorship program by saying that they are removing rumors, removing untruths, right? And so when right after the election, when there was all this discussion about removing untruths and removing rumors, that made me really nervous, because this was sort of like I was hearing this justification. And the thing about this is it has to be credible if we say we're going to remove truths and rumors, right? Because in China, I think, my guess is, I don't have empirical evidence to back this up, but my guess is that the Chinese government saying that they're removing, that they're censoring to remove untruths is not a credible statement, and that this, in fact, makes more rumors believable online. So I have some experiments that I've done where you show people something, you tell them that's censored, and it makes them more interested in that information than if it's not censored, right? And I think that that's a danger of saying, okay, we're going to only show you some things and not others, and if people are aware of that and if that's not credible, if they think that there's some agenda behind removing some information and keeping others, then they're going to become more interested in the information that we're hiding, and that's like backfires against us, right? So there's a lot of ways that censorship in that sense can backfire. So how can we create a media that is credible without making that creation itself seem like it has an agenda? And so those are sort of the three sort of lessons that I was thinking from China.
Hi, I'm Fumi. I want to follow up on that with a few observations. Now, much of my work, or at least one portion of my work, relates to Africa, particularly Nigeria is a focus of my work, and I deal a lot with issues related to technology. So the first thing I want to talk about is truth and information. So I think in many instances in today's world, truth can be very difficult to ascertain, and that's because we might simultaneously have too little information and too much information. And I want to talk about that a bit. And we also tend to sift information through a lens of experience and belief, which sometimes can make ascertaining what is actually accurate difficult. So I want to, if we take truth to be some approximation of actual reality, that requires information transparency. And I think in the United States, to a significant degree, we've had a remarkable amount of information transparency, especially with respect to our leaders. Now, if I compare that to Nigeria, in environments where information is often concealed, obscured, or manipulated, truth can become very elusive. And I think one of the things we do in response to that as humans often, when available information becomes circumscribed, we often tend to have a lot of rumors. So people will make up, they'll create stories and create space for alternative facts. And I think that's something that's really important to recognize, that in the absence of information, it doesn't mean information won't be there. We have too little information, but as a result, we might end up with too much information because there may be just pervasive rumors. And a couple of data points from Nigeria support this. For instance, in Nigeria, it's very unusual to know much about leaders' assets. So the president prior to the current president in Nigeria refused to declare his assets. And actually, that was unusual in the United States until very recently. But somewhat more typical in Nigeria. So I think there are consequences of a culture of concealment by leaders. For instance, the Institute for Security Studies says that public officials should disclose their financial assets as a sign of their commitment to transparency and accountability. And they note it also promotes public trust in government. Now, in the case of Nigeria, one thing that's becoming apparent, recent reports suggest that under the former President Jonathan's regime, the state petroleum company had off-books spending averaging $6 billion a year between 2010 and 2013. So there's a lot of money that went missing. It's not, I think people are trying to round up exactly where that money went, but that's in part a consequence of a lack of transparency. Another place where you see a lack of transparency in many African contexts relates to the health of leaders. So the former president of Nigeria was someone named Umaru Yar'Adua, and he actually got sick in late November 2009 and disappeared from the country to Saudi Arabia until May of the following year when he died. Now during that time period, as you might expect, there was a horrific number of rumors surrounding, you know, weekly rumors about his death. He had a stroke, he had a heart attack, he's died, he's alive. Meanwhile, wasn't entirely clear who was even running the country during this time period. I mean, so in the United States, it would be atypical for a president to disappear for 5 or 6 months. So, and the lack of information transparency makes that disappearance all the more difficult. Now, if you look at Zimbabwe, for instance, there was a wonderful piece of reporting in the New York Times from last September where it noted that people in Zimbabwe track the president's health by tracking his plane. So they actually look on their smartphones and look online to see, well, where is the president's plane today? Oh, the president's plane is in Singapore. We know the president disappeared on a trip somewhere. And his plane showed up in X place. So he's gotten medical treatment, I think we believe, in Hong Kong, in the Gulf states, in the United Arab Emirates. And so these kinds of things that we normally take for granted as being something that we know about our leaders hasn't been true historically in Nigeria, for instance, in other African countries. And I think the future, we'll have to see what happens in the future in the United States. But I would note that we actually do not know a lot about Donald Trump's health either. the next comment I would make is that I think the tracking of people in Zimbabwe, the use of smartphones to track their president and make determinations and derive information about his health, reflects the role of technology in spreading information today. Now, I'm a big fan of technology, I'm a big geek, so technology has many positive attributes. We can do things that we couldn't do without technology. Like I can travel and I can go anywhere, I can go hike and respond to email and no one will know where I am. So it gives us a lot of flexibility in organizing our everyday lives. But there's a shadow of technology that I think we saw, particularly in the last election, in that social media allows for a lot of unintermediated dissemination of information. Now, a lot of that information could be false. One of the things that's interesting when we think about it from the African context, in Africa, many people in Africa today, Nigeria and other countries, have smartphone technology. And in some ways, that allows people to circumvent. In many African countries, the media was controlled by the government post-colonially. So that meant that much information that you were able to access was sifted through the government's lens. Now, social media allows you to get information without access to that government lens. But by the same token, as we're finding out in terms of looking at fake news on Facebook, some of that unintermediated information can be remarkably wrong and incorrect, and in fact can be used by people to encourage agenda setting and ideologies and advance ideologies that may actually be contrary to fundamental values. So that's something that sort of tells us something about the mixed, the technology is mixed. There are very good things about technology, but technology can also be challenging. The last point I would want to make is I think, and this is more about the U.S. than Africa,
yeah.
I think some of the conversation today makes me think a lot about what I refer to as self-truth and how honest we are with ourselves about our own societies and how much our self-honesty contributes to pervasive dissemination of misunderstandings and misinformation. I think to some extent self-truth in the United States at least has been obscured by pervasive narratives of progress. We always say that, you know, we think things are better than in the past, and in some ways that is very true. In some ways it's not, and I'm sort of reminded, comedian Aziz Ansari did a Saturday Night Live monologue the day after the inauguration, which was really interesting. He asked racists to go back to pretending that they weren't racist, and then he talked about what he calls the lowercase KKK. And I think I found the discussion really, really fascinating. I mean, it was very funny, but it was also really, I think, thought-provoking on an important level, because I think in some ways we haven't been honest with ourselves, because I think I hesitate to say how widely, but I think you heard a lot of discussions when Barack Obama got elected that we had moved to a post-racial state in the United States. And I think the reaction and reception to Barack Obama pretty much illustrated very clearly that we are in no way in a post-racial state. And I think one of the things that Aziz Ansari's monologue highlighted for me is that in some ways we may have come to a place where we ignored or gave a pass to casual racism. I also think we also ignore, and I think this came out in the political panel, part of, I think, what's underlying Trump's election in part is the fact that we haven't really taken account of issues related to socioeconomic inequality in the United States and some of the origins of that socioeconomic inequality. And I think if we're going to engage in self-truth or self-honesty, I think we would really have to grapple with that and confront that in ways that we haven't on either side of the political spectrum. And I would also add that, going back to the theme of technology, when we think about the internet, which is positive in many ways, the internet in many ways is also a cesspool. Even prior to the Trump era, you didn't have to dig far beneath the surface to see widespread racist and sexist vitriol that was pervasive on the internet. Look at Twitter. I mean, Twitter would be example number one for that. And last point, I think, as someone who's really engaged with technology, I think we can never assume that the future will be brighter than what we've left behind, that we left behind past legacies of hatred and oppression. And I think it's not coincidental. For me, one of the most striking things, if we look at areas of fiction in the real world that we think of as being the most forward-looking, in many respects, we see areas of real, what I find problematic, regressiveness and lack of real-world diversity. And the two things I would bring up are science fiction. So if you look at the recent controversy surrounding the Hugo Awards and the role of puppies, that suggests to me that even in areas where people are supposedly forward-looking and thinking about the future, they're plagued by some of these same problems. The second place I would point is diversity in the Silicon Valley. That highlights to me that some of the places in our society that we think as being the most forward-looking on some level are also the most aggressive. So I'll leave with that point, and then last but not least, also Gamergate highlights that as well. So I'll leave on that point. I look forward to our continuing conversation.
Thank you. Well, we're just going around to the hot spots of the world. Mine is North Korea, which I think has got to be the gold standard of dictatorships. I think every dictator from these parts to Asia to Africa looks at North Korea and says, how do they do it? And interestingly, the main way they do it is by keeping out the internet. I mean, I think, I wouldn't say this is unique in the world, but North Korea is pretty much the only country that has no internet, except for a very, very tiny percentage of the elite. They have really perfected the art of, the sort of the one, not just the one party state, but the one channel state, the one newspaper state. And, you know, that's why I think dictators study them. There's a wonderful book called The Dictator's Handbook, and that I recommend. But this is, if you want to set up a dictatorship, you've got to get rid of the media, as President Trump is probably now discovering. North Korea has basically banned any outside media, any outside information at all for years. I covered North Korea, by the way. I was for almost 5 years the LA Times correspondent in Seoul. So I spent a lot of time talking to North Koreans about, you know, how they got their information and what they knew. And North Koreans use an expression that I've also heard in China, frogs in the well, but they really know very little about what's going on outside the country. There is only one television station. I mean, there's different branches of it. There's, you know, Rodongshinmun is the state newspaper, and there's different branches in other cities. And, you know, it's all in the service of glorifying this cult of the leadership. You know, they're told that Kim Jong-il, the late leader who died in 2011, you know, hit X many holes and won the first time he played golf. There were double rainbows when he was born on Mount Paektu. Actually, he was born in Russia, but they don't tell you that. You hear the same stuff about Kim Jong-un, the current leader. This is the North Korean system. And it's very interesting because people take this not literally, because I don't think anybody believes it, but they take it seriously because they know that you don't disbelieve that because that's at peril of your life. It's been very interesting for me to watch North Korea the last 10, 15 years because they're really having a hard time maintaining this. And I say this a lot when I speak, but this is a very hard time to be a dictator. I really feel sorry for these guys because you can't, you really can't keep outside information out. And North Korea has had this sort of no news is good news policy, but the underlying lie of the North Korean state, that they are the greatest country on the planet and that they have nothing to envy of the outside world, which is, you know, of course not true. They're one of the poorest countries in the world and maybe the worst place to live. But in order to maintain that lie, they have to keep out every bit of information. So it's not just, you know, VOA or the New York Times or, you know, it's anything. And any bit of information that gets into North Korea is, very corrosive of the system. And this is why I find dealing with North Koreans so fascinating, because when they come out of North Korea, they're like Rip Van Winkles, who woke up to what's going on in the outside world. But so not only do they ban outside broadcasts, they ban, any outside movies, especially current films. The most dangerous thing to bring into North Korea is a South Korean soap opera. And what they're concerned about is, not like sex or violence or politics. What they're concerned about is a scene in the kitchen of the guy who's a truck driver, and you look at that kitchen and you see a bowl of fruit, you see a rice cooker, you see a smartphone, you see a TV, you see all this food and you see this lifestyle. And, the North Koreans know that they're poorer than Americans and Japanese. They know that they don't really know. They know that they're poorer than South Koreans, but they don't know how much poorer. They don't know that they're that much poorer than the Chinese. I also say China is the biggest threat to North Korea because China is booming and relatively free. And when people from North Korea go across the border into China, which they do, people defect across the border to China, they sometimes trade and they come back, they see that Chinese are eating, you know, rice, white rice every day. That's a big, big luxury. And so they have tried to, I think more than any other country, keep this information blockade. That's the nature of their system. So it's fascinating to see them. They're really in trouble these days because you can't really run an economy without information. You know, they're trying to develop their nuclear weapons, their missiles. They need to share technology. They need foreign ideas. They don't want foreign people, but they want ideas. They've been experimenting with something that they call the intranet, which is like kind of an online encyclopedia. You know, if their doctors are researching the latest techniques for dialysis, you know, they can find it. And I think that the North Koreans are also waiting to see if the Chinese perfect their techniques of really controlling the internet. But I think the North Koreans know that the internet is a you know, a powerful river that cannot be controlled. So they keep it out almost entirely. A few technical universities have experimented with limited internet, but it's very, very limited. They've had mobile telephones for about 8-9 years now, and also very limited the amount of information they can transmit. And it's just amazing, after all these years, you still cannot make a telephone call from North Korea to South Korea, or vice versa. People go to the border with China, and they get illegal Chinese cell phones, and they use them to call through China to their relatives in the South. And I keep on hearing people saying, oh, you know, the U.S., we're going to become like North Korea, blah, blah, blah. We're not. You know, we're not. That's hyper.
That's the optimistic takeaway.
Yeah. We're still better off. Anyway, those are my two things.
I'm a social scientist. I'm not an anthropologist, actually. So we talked about method this morning. Which by default means that I'm an ethnographer, and sometimes I do ethnographic work in high-risk situations, oftentimes actually, probably more often than my family would like. I end up doing ethnographic work in high-risk situations, places like Iran or on high-risk topics such as human trafficking in Dubai and Abu Dhabi. So just kind of some of my reflections from today, I was thinking about the morning panel and the use of composites, and I was actually going to posit the question of what about, you know, our method teaches us to use composites for safety reasons, right? So if I were to actually paint a more detailed, if I weren't to combine people into one, they would die, right? They would be arrested. Many times my interlocutors ask me to combine them. And before I publish any of my books, I always show my chapters to my interlocutors to make sure that they're comfortable with how they're being presented. So that was just sort of one thing I wanted to put on the table in thinking about, you know, I really believe that the stories that I tell in my books are stories that need to be told, but they're not stories that can be told with anything other than, you know, protecting people's identities and information. So that was just sort of one thing I wanted to put on the table before talking about the hot spot that I'm gonna focus on, which is Iran. So, you know, the place that I've probably conducted the longest period of ethnographic research of about 7 years is post-revolutionary Iran, where for many people, at least my interlocutors, resistance is a way of life. And for those of you who don't know, 70% of Iran's population is under the age of 35. And in fact, people, numbers are hard to come by. We're terrible at counting, right? When you look at studies about how many Iranians are like in Orange County or LA, and one study will tell you there's, you know, 50,000, another study will tell you there's 1 million. So we're terrible at counting. But I will say, when you walk down the street in Tehran, it is interesting to see the large number of young people, and the demographics sort of, you know, it's something like 50% in the age range of 20 to 35, so it sort of resembles a snake swallowing a rabbit, if you will. And that's really largely due to the pronatalist policies that were enacted in the 80s, shortly after the current regime came to power, followed by a complete 180 in the 90s, which became the family planning program. So in the 80s, families were encouraged to have five or more children. They would get a free plot of land if they had five or more children. In the 90s, they did a complete 180, and fertility rate dropped from, I think, something around 5.7 to 1.7. So, you know, you kind of get the demographics. Highly educated, probably one of the most highly educated countries in the region, highly literate, highest among the highest number of university graduates. 60% of university graduates are women. But a lot of these young people were born into a system of propaganda. Okay, they were born into that, right? And so it's really interesting for me when I was doing my research, when I was teaching, a lot of these young people for whom resistance is a way of life, you know, they question everything, right? They question the information, even if it comports with their own sort of point of view, which is really interesting, right? You know, this is a regime, right, that came to power kind of under a fabric of morality, right, promising to restore the moral order and, you know, promising to reverse the West toxication that had sort of infatuated the populace, right? And, you know, a lot of these young people have been attacking the regime by attacking that fabric of morality, right, and comporting their resistance. And you know, use sometimes consciously, sometimes unconsciously, you know, using their bodies to speak back and kind of gradually chipping away at this sort of fabric of morality, which again, I sort of feeling a little bit of that deja vu. You know, my interlocutors, you know, what I was writing about in my first book was Iran's sexual revolution, right? So it was, you know, young people using their bodies to speak back. And what I mean by that is, you know, where you're in a place where there are, you know, the last panel was about law, right? So there are all these laws, for instance, about public appearance and public, you know, sort of proper behavior. Well, you have young people resisting that, right? You have young people resisting the laws on the books and laws as operationalized by the morality police. And I'll give you a couple for instances. You know, young women would go to university wearing red lipstick. Now, they may be wearing red lipstick because they think it looks great, and I happen to agree with them, it looks great on them. But some of them were wearing it as an act of resistance because there were actual arms of the state in front of the universities, and women's lips were sometimes slashed with razors if they were wearing lipstick, right? So, you know, therefore, whether or not consciously wearing lipstick is an act of resistance, it becomes an act of resistance just by how it's read, right? Another example that I'll give you of a sort of successful act of resistance, and you know, that kind of set the tone for what the sort of the lipstick jihad looked like later. People talk about the summer of the cockroaches, right? Some of the Iranians in the audience will be familiar with this, and I happened to be there during the summer of the cockroaches, and this was basically referring to. Prior to 2004, roughly, there was a law that said if women were walking around wearing nail polish or toe polish, their hands would be dipped in buckets of cockroaches, or there would be cockroaches set free on their toes. Well, at a certain point, it was like, you know, it's really hot, you know, in the summer, and we just want to go out in flip-flops or open-toed shoes. And so everybody decided we're all going to go out wearing open-toed shoes and nail polish, and you know, what are they going to do? There are not enough cockroaches. You can't arrest everybody, right? And there you have it. Now everybody walks around with flip-flops. But so this is what I mean by, you know, people talk about the millimeter revolution, right? The hijab going further and further back, and you see people, young people, carving out spaces for themselves and spaces for their voices, and. You know, part of that is about this inherent distrust of the regime, and part of that is about sort of asserting agency, kind of this indefatigable sense of resistance. But lest I paint too rosy a picture, I should say that I'm one of many people who was expelled from said country, and that really kind of bumps up against, you know, law and how law is written, how law is operationalized, who is interpreting law, and this kind of careful dance that people who engage in the resistance are constantly having to engage in. And you know, prior to being expelled, I spent many hours at Mehrabad Airport, and I just want to sort of speak to the shadow of technology that Fumi brought up. I mean, what the shadow of technology for me is just how dangerous technology is in terms of leading people to your interlocutors or your sources, right? And so, you know, those of us who would move through Mehrabad Airport, and I'm sure many journalists in the room can relate if you've worked on the Middle East, you know, we knew to wipe our computers, right? We knew to send our data via FTP site. We knew to, you know, have go phones, right? These are just things you knew to do to keep yourself and to keep your interlocutors and your loved ones safe, right? You shut down your social media account, right? Because again, social media can be very powerful, but it can also be very dangerous in terms of who it can lead, you know, how many arrests can come from that. And I have to say that I spent a lot of last weekend at LAX airport, and I found it very strange that I was having to give primers to friends of mine moving through US airports about wiping their phones, wiping their laptops, and that sort of, that really strong sense of deja vu that sort of is creeping in. So, I mean, I think I want to sort of leave you with, you know, with the example of Iran and thinking about the panel, the lunchtime panel, about kind of, you know, sort of demand your right to speak up. I think one of the things that I would want you all to take away from thinking about the case of Iran, where again, propaganda and disinformation is something that so many people have been born into and surrounded by, but that resistance has to be a way of life. And also I wanna highlight how precarious that resistance can be. And so how important it is for us to find ways to support the precarity of resistance.
I want to move on by starting with Barbara, actually, because this morning she published a piece on a conspiracy theory, and this brings the discussion back to America. What I was thinking of saying is, so what would happen here that would frighten you based on the experiences you've had someplace else? Or what is it that makes it feel that the difference narrows? And you're talking about the conspiracy theory. Here's something that, if you could just explain what that is. Uh-huh. It's in the paper today, and you said informally that it was the darkest story in some ways you've ever reported.
Yeah.
And when somebody's reported from war zones, and now she's saying that this is an American story, it's as dark as anything she's covered. So just tell us.
I have been looking at, for a couple of months, the Sandy Hook massacre. And as you may or may not know, there are initially a large number of people who believe that it was a hoax. Yeah. And that the official story is that 26 people were killed, 21 of them children, by a single gunman, Adam Lanza, who then killed himself. He had killed his mother earlier in a very, you know, leafy Connecticut suburb. There are a lot of people who think it didn't happen, and that this whole thing was staged by crisis actors. These are terms I've learned recently, and they've been encouraged by Alex Jones, who runs the site InfoWars. InfoWars is possibly about to get White House credentials. Alex Jones has been a strong supporter of Donald Trump's. Trump has been a supporter of Alex Jones, one of the first people he called after the election. I would not say that Trump has endorsed the hoax theory. As far as I know, he's never spoken up about Sandy Hook, but I found it very interesting to write about because I had always thought, covering repressive societies, I just moved from China recently, that these kind of conspiracy theories, urban legends, you know, proliferated in places that don't have free presses and don't have enough information. I think we may be suffering from too much information, which is almost the same as not enough, because you don't know what to believe. And I guess I found it a very troubling story because it's my own country, and I talked to several of the conspiracy theorists, one of whom is an absolutely lovely person, you know, very polite, not stupid, doesn't seem visibly crazy, but they are completely convinced that several hundred people, from children to police to first responders to hospital workers to neighbors, teachers, were all actors. And their craziness has really no bounds. If you start looking this stuff up, it's you know, don't. It's a, but if you do, it's a real, you know, it's really going down the rabbit hole. Look up Sandy Hook conspiracy. Those of you who are online, you'll see, I think, more than 200,000 videos on YouTube, and some of them have millions and millions of hits. And it's, you know, it's just, it's very scary. I don't know what to say. I haven't reached any conclusions about really what causes it. These are really the same people who propagated the Pizzagate conspiracy, that Hillary Clinton's supporters were running a child sex ring out of a pizza parlor in Washington. I mean, you hear about this and you just laugh, you know how on the surface how ridiculous this is. But, you know, they can be dangerous. And, I mean, this guy drove up from North Carolina with an assault rifle and fired into the place to free the children. You know, fortunately, there were no children and nobody was hurt. Some of these Sandy Hook conspiracies are quite dangerous, too. There's one guy I spoke to who's been, he lives in Florida, he's been to Sandy Hook 22 times. Most of the parents have, like, completely gone off of social media. They're really in deep hiding. They have unlisted addresses, unlisted phone numbers, because they've been harassed. A lot of it is very anti-Semitic. A lot of it is pornographic. It is very, very ugly. I mean, the underlying theory is that Sandy Hook was staged by Democrats as an excuse to take away our guns. And, you know, I just think, you know, we, the real press, have to, you know, keep on reporting the facts. And I don't really understand how it is that the mainstream press lost as much credibility as we had. I would like to ask other panelists who are not.
Where was this published?
In the LA Times. I'm not the first one. I did a long report. I'm not the only one who's written about it. It's gotten relatively little attention because the people in Sandy Hook who have been victims don't want to speak about it, because this is another form of censorship that I'm finding now just in the last few months. They don't want to be attacked by trolls. And I was advised by, I talked to other reporters who've written about it, I was advised also to change all my email passwords and take things offline. That's why I was late yesterday, yeah, in part. Anybody who writes about it gets trolled, and any parent who talks about it, because they've really gone after the parents. The person who I wrote about was the most, I think, outwardly Jewish, and he might have been attacked the first, but they said his child didn't exist, and that the child was, you know, a fake, that the death was a fake. They demanded that he produce death certificates, then birth certificates, and then that he exhumed the body. And, you know, there's these people, you read the stuff, I mean, on the internet, or don't, but, you know, they believe that the children were actors, and that the children are all alive, and that they were in the Super Bowl the year afterwards singing. Anyway, there is dark stuff out there, and, you know, maybe next year we'll talk more about conspiracy theories. I am told by experts in the subject that the current round of conspiracy theories are mostly directed against the Democratic establishment, and that soon the conspiracy theories will flip to be directed against Trump. And I'm beginning, on some of these kind of dark web sites, I'm beginning to see some of that, but it doesn't make it better.
So now that we're all thoroughly depressed,
wow.
And if we can then, rather than say, describe, we'll go to questions soon, but rather than say, describe something that is feeling this deja vu of distancing, what's something that gives you hope that is still different? I wrote a piece about feeling that the difference between China and the United States, I co-wrote a piece with Mara Cunningham on feeling that the distance between the Chinese and U.S. systems was narrowing, in ways that I thought I would never see. And we said that, of course, there are ways that it's still different. There are courts that respond differently than the central authorities as an utterly key thing. There is multiple media, still a good thing on the whole. But one of the responses on Twitter from a friend who's also worked in authoritarian saying was so many of the factors we listed could be read as not yet. But I think the not yet's very important. So I wonder, what is it that as you live through this moment gives you a sense that, okay, but if my friends, I think Pardis, you were saying that you have friends in Cairo saying, mm-hmm. welcome to our world. Mm-hmm. And I've had that response from people too. But what can you say back? You can say yes, but.
It's a great question. It's something I've been thinking about a lot, right? Because so many of my friends from around the world, particularly in the Middle East, are like, yes, now you've entered our world, our realities, you know, post-election. But one of the things that I often say back, and it's actually interesting because I think it relates to the subject of your conference from last year, but and it's not to say the main thing I would say to speak back to that is this issue of academic freedom. Okay, and it's not to say that academic freedom isn't under attack, but it's under attack in very, very different ways than it is in other parts of the world. And I think one of the things that I've been really heartened by is just the increased public discourse around academic freedom and just how many people are kind of rallying around that. Whereas, you know, I often tell my friends in Iran that, for those of you who know, there's a prison in Tehran, Evin prison, right? But it's sort of nicknamed Evin University because there are so many professors in there and or so many academics have been in there at one time or another, right? I work with an organization called Scholars at Risk. Every year there are, well, this year Turkey trumped Iran. But every year, you know, there are more Iranians, you know, scholars at risk who are having to be evacuated from Iran due to their very lives being threatened because of their academic freedom, because of what they've written. And so I will say that you know, we're definitely not there yet, right? We're definitely...
Well, we're here.
We're here.
This event would not take place
right,
in North
right.
Korea or in China.
Or Iran.
Yeah.
Right. And I think that's really important, right, that we're able to engage in these conversations still and we're able to sort of speak what we think without worrying that we're going to end up in Evin University.
Do you have any, Fumi or Molly, that you want to...
I would say a couple of things. I think in the sense I see it as a wake-up call, I think we take our system for granted in the United States and we take a lot of the liberties and rights we have for granted. And when you travel also in the world, I think you tend to take that less for granted because you see that other people don't have that. So the way I would think about this in a more positive light is to say that we can really learn from this experience. I think it may be painful for many people, but I think it will show us, hopefully, this is my optimistic side coming out, will show us the resilience of our system and also show us that our system is something that you can't just take for granted. It requires that we invest and that we fight to preserve the rights that we do have.
So I think I would echo this academic freedom. I mean, certainly intellectuals and journalists are the first, right, that are attacked. And I think that we have, you know, such a long history of protecting academics that I think that's really important that we're having this conversation today, for example. I would also say that I think that they're increasingly, I'm really excited about increasing transparency from local governments and from government around in the U.S. So there's a lot of new data online from governments. There's a lot of increasing data journalism that I think is allowing us to really look at facts and also be for the public to be able to grapple with data on local governments. And I hope that continues and we're able, the public is able to, first of all, interpret and see data and interactive graphics, like things on the upshot. I think that those trends in journalism are really exciting and validate facts.
All right, great. Let's get other people involved in the audience. This is, people have been through a long time and a lot of people are eager to say things. So here are questions.
Yes, absolutely. And that's why I think one of the points I made was I think we need to be more honest with ourselves. I think in some ways we can preemptively shut down discussion about topics where we say we all agree, and I think it's important to have that discussion. I mean, I might not disagree with Aziz Ansari. In a sense, I would rather that the lowercase KKK be out there than not talk, because I think it's important that we know about these sentiments, because you can't sort of live in a world where you deny that if it's out there and you see it every day. If you don't see it, we can all live with this comfortable fantasy that all those things are in the past and that they don't exist. But I think the reality is they do exist, and they connect exactly back to that history that you're talking about.
I'm not going to answer that, but I want to bring one thing in, because Molly's work is what I've learned the most from about this. In that setup, that dichotomy, I think North Korea is a dichotomy with closing off the internet. China is often held up as the example of the controlled internet. And the whole focus was on censorship. We had somebody speaking here making a joke, which was great. Our metaphor was always the great firewall. So big you can see it from cyberspace. That's Kaiser Guo's joke. But what he said is that there was so much focus on the censorship, there wasn't enough focus on what else was going on in the internet in China, which was that a lot of discussion on the internet about the internet in China among people focusing on China, not just in a passing way, was about flesh-eating search engines, about the real nastiness of possibility. The flooding, Molly's written about the flooding of bad information on the internet. We were focused so much on the contrast between free circulation of information and that controlled place over there that we actually miss how a lot of authoritarian states have this flooding of that, which does it. And you can expand more on it, but I think that's part of the problem, is that we think of this contrast between control and free rather than the problematic side, which is also the conspiracy.
Yeah, I think kind of going off of this is so there's one view of censorship, right, where you're making information less available, you're agenda setting by hiding information, right? And what the Chinese government does when they can't hide a piece of information because it's already out there is they try to distract from it. So we see a lot of times where there'll be sort of a whole bunch of people writing online at the behest of the government to distract from something that's going on in the system. And that's a form of censorship, because it's setting the agenda by trying to say, look over here instead of looking over there. And I think we see that a lot in the US because if you can't control information by controlling the infrastructure, but by controlling it, you can control it by coordinating distraction online. So I think that the question that this, what this makes me think about a lot, and I don't have a good answer, is how do we signal credibility, right? So we have a situation where there's anyone can write anything online and coordinate it and distract, but how can credible information, how can people with credible information show that it's credible, credibly signal that it's credible, right? In a way that other people who are spreading misinformation cannot, right? How can we signal to the public that this information is different from other information that anyone can post online? And I think some of that has to do with transparency. So being very clear about how that information was collected, how the process of information came, and you know, making data when we can available, and that type of thing. I think another part of that is what political scientists think about as costly signaling. So we talk a lot in game theory about cheap talk, where if there's no cost for you to say something, then why would I believe it that you say it? And in, certainly in the internet age, you can put anything online and use no cost to you, right? So how do we explain to people that as academics and as journalists that there are costs to our profession, to our personal, to ourselves if we say something that's not right, that's not true? Can we explain that very clearly to the public, and would that make them believe us more? And I think those are open questions. How can we sort of say, if this isn't true, something, I'm putting my credibility on the line here, and if this isn't true, something, not terrible, but something, but I'm going to live up to that. How can we do that? And that's, I think, the hard part. I don't have a good answer.
Yeah,
reflect on my two different fields. So once I got expelled from Iran, I was an anthropologist without a field site, so I moved to the Gulf, right? And it's interesting because Dubai, and you know, has this veneer of having something kind of in the middle, right? There is this idea that it's not like censored the way that it is in Iran, but it's not necessarily, you know, like the U.S., right? But one thing I find really interesting is that actually in Iran, I found that it was much easier to access more true or honest information. And I think one of the things I have to refer back to is the panel from last night, and it's the role of art. And here I want to speak about Iranian cinema and all the filmmakers who talked about censorship as making their films so much more robust and so much more true, right? You have so many filmmakers who talk about sort of truth and the truth in their fictional films, right? And so much of what I saw and continue to see coming out of Iran are these really, that censorship has birthed creativity. And there's been these incredibly creative ways of moving around that. And that does give me some hope. So even if I think about, well, Dubai is technically kind of that middle sort of ish, you know, I still actually think that a lot of what's coming out of Iran is more nuanced.
Did I pay you to ask that question, Nick? We are old friends. I think in general, you know, as reporters, and you've been a foreign correspondent too, several of you have, defectors and refugees will often exaggerate their stories, and this is not unique to North Koreans. Actually, I found North Koreans to be pretty good in, relative to other people I've interviewed. I think some of it is that they kind of feel like you've traveled a long way and they want to give you what you came to hear. And they want to, you know, they want to speak up to the abuses in their countries, and, you know, it may not be something that happened to them, but it happened to their cousins, neighbors, cousin, da-da. So you get a lot of that stuff. I think with many of the North Korean accounts, have been exaggerated. A lot of the memoirs have gotten into trouble. When I did my book about North Korea, I focused on six people from the same city, and I did that specifically, but I interviewed really more several hundred people from this same town, and I did that specifically so that I could cross-check what they said. When people tell you, you know, a horrible story, I think Samantha Power put this very well. You know, she said, it's not that you think they're lying, but you can't believe it. You can't, like, sort of accept that in your heart of hearts. And, you know, you apply the same standard as you do to, you know, a court, where if 12 witnesses are telling you, you know, we saw children who had starved to death behind the train station in 1996, and they're all telling the same story, and you interview them separately, you begin to believe it. And so I've tried to apply that standard to reporting on North Korea. I did a piece for the LA Review of Books on this. There's a lot of sensational reporting coming out of North Korea because it's such a weird place with between the weird hair and you can believe anything about it. And they've kind of been libel-proof for years because they're not like, it's not like the Minister of Information is calling you the next day and saying, that story was unfair. They don't say anything. And so, one of the examples I give was an editorial in a very prominent East Coast newspaper that said when North Koreans steal food, they're burned at the stake and their relatives are made to light the fire. And when I asked North Korean defectors about this, they're just like, ha ha, you know how much firewood costs in North Korea? Why would we do that? And, you know, there's a lot of stories about Christians being, you know, killed, crushed by steamrollers and all this stuff. And I mean, the truth of the matter is that if you steal food in North Korea, you're sent away to a labor camp and worked to death, and you'll probably die over the course of 9 months and it's probably just as bad. But it's not as dramatic. And I mean, the truth is bad enough. And I mean, I just, you read carefully. And in terms of what the regime says to the outside world, this is like, don't quote me on this, but KCNA, which is their news services, can actually be pretty reliable. And I've talked to people, you know, at State and formerly of the CIA who follow North Korea, and, you know, a lot of their hyperbole turns out to be true, you know, in terms of the nuclear weapons they're developing and the long-range missiles. And they often do say what they're going to do. So, you know, there you go. That's not very inspiring.
The question's about what use fiction set in these very difficult to know about places does. Does it do harm or good?
I think it generally does good. I mean, the case of Adam Johnson's novel, which uses some, you know, techniques of magic realism. There are things in the novel, like there's a lobotomy scene, and there's a lot of stuff that just is not true. And it's really not his fault, but I find a lot of readers get confused. And if you look at the reviews on Amazon, you'll see like a lot of people saying, oh, I had no idea that North Korea was this bad. And one review called my book a novel and his nonfiction, which was, you know, I mean, my book was excerpted in The New Yorker. I went through this like excruciating fact-checking where we spent like 3 hours with one of the sources about whether something was a pumpkin or a squash, and through translators. So I find it, I find it kind of galling. But in general, I think his book, which I loved, raised awareness about North Korea, and there are things that you can tell in a novel that you can't in nonfiction. This is what Pardis was talking about earlier. You know, you have to protect your sources and your real people.
Okay, so just a couple of comments, particularly on this notion of what we can do to sort of make people believe facts or see if people believe facts. So I think, and what about people not reading, right? So as an educator and also someone who studies the media, I think that there's sort of two tacks that I take on this. One is, I think we have to teach people, so I teach intro to statistics for social scientists, and for a long time we've been talking about, in a lot of reporting on particularly like health studies, how to think critically about this type of reporting, right? So some health studies will, a health study will come out and it will have a particular conclusion, and then the article written about that study will sort of, won't talk about sort of the nuance or the problems with that academic study, and so how could they go and find that source and actually read the study and interpret it themselves. So some of that is it's just teaching people how to read the media better, but I also think it relies on the media to be able to read the study and talk and explain the nuance, right? So what are the other potential confounders? Was this an experiment? How many people were actually in this study? So I'll go and, there'll be an article about how something is really bad for you, and then you go to the actual article and there are 25 people in the study, and you wonder about the result, and it goes against the entire literature, which makes it newsworthy, but is that something that we should believe? The other is trying to study actually what do people believe, and I've started working on using news headlines as signals of fact, and trying to understand how, when you give people news headlines, which may be the only thing that they read, how do they update their beliefs about facts and paying them to get the right answer to the fact, so it's not, to making sure it's not a cheerleading result. And one thing that I found preliminarily is that some headlines lead people away from facts. And so that some headlines are especially really sensational, and so then they tend to sort of lead people away from a fact that really there wasn't that big of a change, but it seems like there was a huge change, right? And then there are other headlines that lead people toward the fact. And so trying to use empirical studies of how people are updating their beliefs when they're reading facts to say, okay, these are headlines that are helping people distinguish between truth and untruth. And these are headlines that if people don't end up reading the article, they're actually leading them astray because of sort of the spin. So I think that actually trying to figure out what do people believe and how can we do experiments to try to understand how we're communicating and if we're miscommunicating. I think that's really important.
So we just go down?
Yeah.
Okay, I would just say two quick things. I think I'm maybe not as much of an optimist about some of these issues because I think we live in a world where we're very distracted. I think President Trump is very distracted when you look at him, and I think he sort of exemplifies what we see going on in the broader society. Technology, I mean, we're often doing three or four things at once, and I think that distraction makes it very difficult for us to focus on anything for very long. So a lot of times on some websites, they'll say this article takes 8 minutes because they know that people, they have like 2 minutes of people's attention today. So I think we have very, very short attention spans today, and that's partly due to technology. The second thing I would add, this came up on one of the earlier panels, we have high expectations of drama. So part of what maybe is going on with this election is we're gonna see the White House as reality TV. So, you know, that's very exciting. And the real world is not so exciting. Real facts are not so exciting. They're not so dramatic. And I think those two things are things we have to figure out how to incorporate into whatever kind of education we're doing. Those two things, I think, are present realities that we have to deal with.
I guess I'm somewhat more optimistic. I think the one good thing that came out of this election cycle is the focus on fake news and real news and telling the difference. And I think readers are hopefully becoming more sophisticated. I've seen several universities have started teaching classes and, you know, distinguishing news and how to be a news reader. So, you know, hopefully people will be smarter and more sophisticated. I think, you know, in the case of conspiracy theories and rumors, you know, I think Nick Lehman put the dichotomy very well. You've got, you know, North Korea on the one hand, you have this, you know, libertarian information flow. In the U.S., I mean, the laws and the court cases have not quite caught up. There are, even in China, by the way, there's, you know, there's laws against spreading rumors. I think Molly was referring to this, and when I talked to people about Sandy Hook, they were saying, well, the Chinese have it right. They don't allow you to spread these kind of destructive rumors. Yeah, but, you know, some rumors, some conspiracy theories are true. We don't have anybody from Central America on the panel, but, you know, sometimes they are true.
Well, Watergate seemed like a conspiracy theory.
You know, so, you know, I don't know where the right balance is. There's a lot of very destructive stuff on the internet. The New Yorker has done several excellent pieces about trolling and revenge porn. And I mean, if you're attacked online, you've got to be very tough. People can really cause a lot of damage. And, you know, I know many people have had troll attacks. I've had troll attacks. I probably will have a lot more. And if you're an ordinary person who's not a journalist and not used to getting, you know, death threats, you know, 20 death threats in your email, you know, it's pretty terrifying. So, you know, I don't know where it will shake out.
Yeah, I'm not as optimistic. I think as an educator, I think that we actually need to be a lot more honest about our pedagogies and about our epistemologies. And I think that a lot of this sort of teaching of critical thinking and teaching students how to disagree, I mean, we're not really role modeling that very well as educators. I think we need to be better about that. I think we need to think about our pedagogy, about situating knowledge. And I'm really glad the one optimistic sort of turn of events is the question of diversity, and the diversity in the curriculum is very much on the table now, and it's very much out there, and we're very much discussing it. And I think that may lead to more honest pedagogy, but until our students can trust us as educators and to buy their trust, we have to be really reflexive and think about questions of diversity and inclusion. Until we can earn that trust, then we can't do a great job of teaching them then how to be critical and also how to disagree.
I want to leap in one moment because Orwell didn't really get the attention and the answers, but I actually think we should forget Orwell. I know he's one of my favorite writers, but we're paying too much attention to his particular dystopia. And this relates to the question of the disbelief of propaganda in
the former Soviet bloc. In that bloc, one reason why it could be overthrown was because people, many people, had the same shared view of the state and a disbelief, whether they were a disbelief in what was coming out there. I think the dystopias that are much scarier now in a divided, distracted society are actually more like Huxley's Brave New World. Mm-hmm. And amusing ourselves to death, which was contrasting those two, is seeming a very prophetic work as well. The era of distraction is partly, and the idea that there is not a whole unified group here that are not believing what's coming out of the White House and what's the distractions are coming. There is, even if it's a third. And I think one of the things that is a way to be a little more hopeful than Pardis does, I think actually what we need is more events like this kind of thing, where you actually have people who are disagreeing, not that we're disagreeing that much, but the lunchtime talk, I want to think about that. Would we, if there had been a different election, still had a Democrat and Republican, or would we have these different, we need to have that kind of thing.
Yeah.
We need to have people who were on different sides in the election arguing that. If we had that last year with the What Cannot Be Said, with people staking out very different points of view on that, and we can, one of the ways to work against a bubble is to think about developing the skills of arguing back and forth. And that, Amy wants to have some final words, and you have to come up here because there it is. So.
What a great panel this was. These are my closing remarks for the whole thing. I did want to thank Fumi for not getting into all the incredible rumors with which the Nigerian government manages to distract the Nigerian people from what's really going on. I wanted to say that at the beginning of this, we talked about how President Trump seemed to be backtracking a little bit from the various things he's done in his first week and a half. This is what Donald Trump was doing while we were having this conference. 3 hours ago, Donald Trump tweeted, "What is our country coming to when a judge can halt a Homeland Security travel ban? And anyone, even with bad intentions, can come into the US?" 2 hours ago. "Because the ban was lifted by a judge, many very bad and dangerous people may be pouring into our country. A terrible decision." 57 minutes ago. "Why aren't the lawyers looking at and using the federal court decision in Boston, which is at conflict with ridiculous lift ban decision?" I don't know what that is. You, Judge Rinko. Now, Donald Trump tweeted, "Interview with O'Reilly Factor on Fox News, 4 o'clock p.m. prior to Super Bowl. Enjoy." So you know what Trump does while we're here. I did feel that maybe we're in a kind of bubble. I mean, when we were talking about academic freedom in the United States, and here we are, okay, it's Orange County, which did this time go for Hillary, am I right? But it hasn't always. And so we're in a safe space within a safe space. But what if we were having this conference somewhere else in the United States? I'm not sure anymore that, I'm not that confident, although my husband will yell at me on the way home, that we would be entirely safe. And when the window shades came down last night, and I said to everyone, relax, you know, I was a little nervous. Okay, here are some final just notes to you. My colleague and old friend, Nick Lemon, says he'll send us his guidelines for journalism practices, which is called the journalistic method. And if you will put your email on the forum's mailing list outside, we will send it to you. But he tells me it is a public document. Where can people find it if they want to find it without my good office's name? Okay, he'll just send it to me. We don't want him to get trolled for it, so we'll do it kind of private. Yeah. Okay. All right. Yeah, I get it. Lower your expectations. It's not a very good document. So there's a staff person outside, one or two, who will show you where you can put your emails, and we won't bother you, but we'll just let you know what conferences we're doing, et cetera. I wanted to, again, thank UCI's School of Humanities and its law school for supporting us, and the Literary Journalism Program as well. Thanks to all the incredible panelists. This was another outstanding panel, I thought, today. here.